Welcome back to our intermediate financial accounting class. In this segment, we get to continue on with our discussion of finishing the income statement. We've talked quite a bit about taxes, which are perhaps the biggest piece of wrapping up our income statement. And there were a lot of details, fun stuff that we got to talk about with taxes. Now that we've finished up taxes, and we did in our last example, the calculation from income before taxes with this deferred tax, income tax expense calculation, getting us to net income, we can talk about the last part of wrapping up the income statement, and that's creating our earnings per share number. Now, we've done a bit with earnings per share in past discussions, as we talked about the income statement and how we build the financials, but it's time to move from the simplified version that we were talking about to the real version that's actually required by FASB. So we're going to break our discussion down into a couple of pieces. You can see it right up here. We'll start by talking about basic earnings per share. Then we'll talk about the calculations of what we call diluted earnings per share. And finally, we'll talk a little bit about how we account for those dilutive securities. That way we make sure we get our journal entries in as part of this discussion. And it's not just all tables and calculations. Now, before we start jumping into our methodology, we want to take just a minute, as always, to talk about why this topic is so important for us in financial accounting. Well, keep in mind that earnings per share is considered the most important number in accounting. It's used by everyone, investors, analysts, decision makers, regulators, etc. Everybody focuses on this earnings per share number. It's actually one of the criticisms of our American system is that our stock markets and other markets are so fixated on earnings per share that they kind of blot out the other information provided in the financial statements. There's been some fascinating research that shows that investors see what's on the financial statements and use that information and exclude everything else. And of all the numbers they see in the financial statements, they focus on earnings per share. So what we see is this, well, functional fixation, that's the psychology term, where you get blinders on and you're just looking at this one number. Now, for good or ill, that's how the American system works, which means we have to be really good at understanding earnings per share for several reasons. First, because as an internal accountant, a CFO, controller, etc., we have to be able to make this calculation, make it correctly, and explain it to our senior managers and to others who might be interested. Keep in mind, you may have to justify why earnings per share is higher and lower than they think it should be in order to make sure that you're following GAAP. For auditors, we're checking this earnings per share number. We know how important it is for investors and for other market participants and stakeholders, so we have to make sure this number is correct. Finally, as investors, we want to know what goes on in earnings per share so that we can use that information for our own investment. So wherever you fall as a financial accounting user or as an accountant, you need to be comfortable with this earnings per share number. Let me just share one quick example of how functionally fixated we really are on this earnings per share number and how important it's become to our US markets. There's a study out there that talks about how earnings per share is calculated. You see, FASB is very specific. Earnings per share must be reported to the penny, must be. So unlike other ratios that can be calculated to 3, 4, 1, however many decimal places you want, the earnings per share number has to be reported to the nearest penny. So researchers started looking into this to see how much do companies need to manipulate their books to make sure that earnings per share number shows up the way we want it. Well, because of that loophole that you report it at the nearest penny, we've actually been able to show, or this paper has been able to show, that multi-billion dollar companies sometimes need to manipulate their earnings by as little as $500 because they just need to be able to round up. So if I am trying to get to earnings per share of $1.30 and I'm at 1.294, all I have to do is manipulate to 1.295 and I can round up to $1.30. So because of this focus on earnings per share, we can get down to very, very small manipulations in our financial statements and still be able to convince the market that we're doing very, very well, or at least meeting the expectation the market has set for us. So keep in mind, this number is checked, it's double checked, but it's also played around with to make sure that we can report the numbers that our investors want to see. Now, along with the basic earnings per share that we've played around with. There's also a new kind of earnings per share that we're going to be introducing in this chapter, and that's diluted earnings per share. Now, we'll talk about diluted earnings per share more as we get going, but it's based on the securities that are out there that allow investors to buy or convert or get, however they do it, shares of our stock. So this includes stock options, it includes convertible debt, it includes convertible preferred stock, etc. And these types of securities are becoming really popular in the market. They're popular with investors because they allow them to invest at a set price whenever they want to within a time range. They're popular because they allow us to switch from debt to equity if we think your company is going to grow. And they're popular with companies because it allows the company to get more money. If I want to sell you a bond and I can't make all the interest payments that I want to, if I throw in a conversion option, so if you decide you like equity better, you could switch from a $1,000 bond to 5 shares of common stock. Well, that reduces the risk to the bondholder, allows them to get in on this growth, and they're willing to pay me a premium, not because of the interest that I'm paying, but because of the option that I've given them to get shares of stock. So it's a way for companies to raise that present value of our bonds and still avoid making really large interest payments. So these dilutive securities that we're going to talk about, both how they affect earnings per share, but also how you do some of the journal entries for them, have become a really big part of the market. And you can blame that on finance people or accounting people. It's just a smart combination of the accounting rules and the financial decision-making team to figure out how we can best finance our operations without having to pay a lot of cash in the future. So because of that, both earnings per share and these dilutive securities have become a really important part of our marketplace. Now, earnings per share is one of the essential pieces of the financial statements. It must be included for your income statement to be in good form, meaning acceptable to FASB, the SEC, banks, etc. If you're omitting earnings per share, you are not following GAAP. So this number has to appear in your financial statements. Usually we report at least 2 earnings per share numbers, but we may have more than that depending on the size of our company. So you can see right here the list of 3 earnings per share numbers that are typically calculated. So we usually will report earnings per share on income from continuing operations, earnings per share on income from discontinued operations, and then the one we're more familiar with, earnings per share on net income. According to GAAP, you have to include the 2 with an asterisk, income from continuing operations and net income. You don't have to include it from discontinued operations, number 1, because not all companies have discontinued operations, and number 2, because they're being discontinued, so they're going away. So a lot of companies will choose to throw in that middle form of earnings per share, but it's not required. Just so you know, we're going to move forward and focus on that net income version, but the methods and calculations and everything else we do work exactly the same for the other 2 numbers. We just substitute income from continuing operations or income from discontinued operations for net income. Now, the equation for earnings per share is really basic, and we've used this in the past. We take our net income number or the other income numbers, we subtract out the preferred stock dividends, and we divide by the weighted average common stock shares outstanding. Now, we use net income because that's the profit the company has made. We take out the preferred stock dividends because they're not voting owners. They get their dividend first, but they're not controlling shareholders. They have no vote. So since they don't actually act as owners of the company, we're not going to include them in this earnings per share calculation. So we take out the part of net income that's going to them, and then we divide by the real owners, the voting common stockholders that own our firm. Now, we've been using a simplification for the weighted average common shares outstanding. We've taken beginning plus ending and divided by 2. But that's just a simplification. It's kept things easy for us as we've been learning other ideas and topics, but now it's time to use the real version. So one of the fun things we get to talk about in coming segments is how we really do that weighted average calculation. Before we get into that, though, we have a couple more conceptual issues that we need to discuss. First off, we need to talk about how we classify earnings per share. And we've already talked about this just a little bit, but I want to hit it again because the difference between basic earnings per share and diluted earnings per share is one of our key concepts. So make sure you're comfortable with these differences. Basic earnings per share is calculated on the common shares currently issued and outstanding. How many real voting shares are out there? and we use a weighted average number of these shares, and we report this value on all good form income statements. And that's basic earnings per share. And that's what we've been doing, that's what we've been using. We're just focusing on the shares that really exist. Diluted earnings per share is a worst case scenario. What if everybody who could buy or get a share of my stock right now did? So everybody who's got a stock option exercises their stock options and buys shares. Everybody who's got convertible bonds or other convertible debt, everybody who's got a convertible preferred stock, if they all converted and bought their stock options right now, what would that do to earnings per share? Well, if you issue all these new shares of stock, your earnings per share number is going to drop a lot. And that's what FASB wants to show to investors. You see, there was some concern back in the 1960s and 70s about companies issuing a lot of stock options. And FASB was worried that current investors would not realize how much control was being given away to employees as part of these stock options. So they determined that we'd use this diluted earnings per share method as a way to signal to investors how quickly and how fast their ownership share could drop because of the decisions management was making on giving away these options. So that's what diluted earnings per share is for. It's a way of showing how fast your earnings per share would drop if everybody could get their stock right this very second. Now, that doesn't mean people are really rushing in to do it. It just is a what if. It's a pretend. So think of the world of make-believe from Mr. Rogers or whatever your favorite kid show was growing up. That's what we're doing with diluted earnings per share. There's no journal entries for it because it hasn't really happened. It's just what would happen if. And the important piece here, other than understanding the conceptual idea that basic is based on real shares outstanding, diluted is a worst case scenario, please keep in mind, both of them have to show up on an income statement in good form or you're not following GAAP. There is one exception to that rule, and I hate talking about exceptions when I've just tried to emphasize it. This has to be there, this has to be there. But there are some companies with no dilutive securities. So I've never issued stock options. I don't issue convertible debt. I don't have any preferred stock at all. If you're a small corporation, maybe an S corp or something that is following GAAP instead of cash accounting, but doesn't have any of these dilutive securities, then you report what we call simple earnings per share. And the term simple earnings per share indicates that I don't have dilutive items. So the only thing I can report is a basic earnings per share number. And that's what the term simple signifies. I don't have any dilutive securities. I can't give you a diluted earnings per share number. We talked about a bunch of conceptual issues. It's time to jump into some calculations. We're going to start off with just basic earnings per share, doing it the real way instead of the simple way. Fun stuff in those calculations. We'll see you then. Thanks.